Anno 1503 is the second title in the Anno city building series, but it's the third Anno title that I have played. I've started with 1701, The Sunken Dragon, and enjoyed playing it quite a bit, then 1404, which I enjoyed even more, and now it's time to see how 1503 fares. So join me after the upcoming call to action if you're interested in seeing more of Anno 1503.
Hey there, Relive Me here. Some rather massive and relevant Anno related news were announced as I was editing this video, so please make sure to stick around till the end where I actually address it. But for now, back to the original recorded script.
Bloop. If this is the first time on my channel, welcome, welcome. I'm Steven Hansen's Geek Culture Analyst, City Building Extraordinaire. I bring you indie RPG strategy and city builder reviews, so make sure to subscribe if you enjoy what I'm trying to build here. If you're already a subscriber, welcome back and remember to click that bell button, it really helps a lot. If you look back at my Anno 1701 and Anno 1404 videos, upper right corner, you'll notice how these ones feature pretty solid and time-appropriate 3D graphics. Anno 1503 was made 3 years before Anno 1701 in 2003, and as such, it, for some reason, still features some top-notch pixel art. I mean, this stuff is beautiful to look at. It makes me think I'm playing a Knights and Merchants sequel we never got. The style is so detailed and realistic that it makes it especially interesting to zoom in and out. I don't know if you could do this in the original game or if it's something implemented in the GOG version, but it's hella nice. I love zoom features in pixel art games. But there is a bit of a pitfall that comes with this realistic and detailed take, in that it makes everything look very samey and homogenous. Once your houses start evolving into using bricks for their walls, most of the other service buildings will start to blend into the overall city layout. Idea being that you need to know which buildings cover which areas, and this will mean that you'll have to click a lot around to find the particular type of building that you're looking for. Or you play the game for so long that you start to automatically recognize them. Road networks are a crucial part of all city building games, and most of your buildings normally need road access in order to function. In Anno 1503, each building has several access points to which you can connect roads on several, if not all, sides of the building. Most of them are 3x3 squares, and the road access spots are the middle square. This sounds like it's a great idea and offers a certain amount of flexibility in your city layout planning, but I found it to be confusing and really hard to get used to. This is obviously due to most other city builders not being so specific about road access. It's either one access point, or it doesn't matter where the roads connect as long as they touch one side of the building. You can move the camera and see where the road access points are on the opposite sides, which you might need to do, but that is generally super confusing and I never do it with any sort of pleasure. It's a cool feature, don't get me wrong, because you get to see the gorgeous pixel art in all its entirety, and you will need it especially to properly place roads and quarries on different sides of mountains, but it's always mind-bending in a bad way. So everything about the UI, the buttons, the number and style of icons, everything about the UI is very extra. They went with a somewhat realistic design approach. I mean, the exit button is a door. This means they have to be rather large because of the limited resolutions possible back in 2003. The gist is, the user interface is clunky and overly complicated. Overall, the graphics have very pleasantly surprised me. The sprite animations as well. The wild animals roaming are pretty cool. They do not attack your people like they do in Stronghold or Caesar 3 for that matter, but on the other hand, the sheep are loud as hell. I mean, just check this out. Insane. Thankfully, you can turn the volume down on sound effects. The warehouses on any given island still communicate with each other through a form of possibly ancient ancestor inherited teleportation technology without needing to be connected by roads, but that's pretty much a trademark of the series by now. I am actually curious if they carried it to their Anno 1800 title. I like that you need to use an actual scout unit with a donkey in tow, no less, to discover what kind of minerals you can mine from the variety of mountain ranges. Similarly, you need to colonize other islands in order to grow all the resources you need to improve the level of your people, and there is still combat in the game. A lot of it by the looks of the many things you can build, but as per usual, I do not play city builders for combat, and I avoid that type of content. If I want to get into fights and still do some amount of building, I'll play something like Aggressor's Ancient Rome, Warhammer 40k Gladius, or Old World.
but that's just me, your mileage may vary. Now, onto the things I normally don't talk about in these reviews, but this is a case where I feel I have to, because the issues I had with running it on Windows 10, I believe influenced my decision of dropping the game earlier than I think I would have normally otherwise. Running GOG versions of older games is usually fine with Windows 10. Haven't really had that many issues in general, but Anno 1503 has been something special. Even after getting it to run, which was a bit of a pain, I could not alt-tab out of it to do other things, which I understand might not be a big problem for most people out there, but I tend to listen to podcasts or watch videos while I play, and I do have to click away from the game from time to time. But whenever I would do that in Anno 1503, I'd return to lording over the spectral forms of my population, which would kinda be a cool idea for a city builder, but Afterlife already did it. On a lighter note, let me point out a funny translation mishap present in the GOG version of the game. For a little bit of background, the Anno series were first created in Germany, just like some other somewhat similar titles like The Settlers or Patrician. Which reminds me yet again that I maybe should play Patrician 3 soon. Also, quick tangent, goddamn, the Germans made a lot of resource management / strategy games because Settlers of Catan is also a German game. I just guess there was a lot of knowledge in the German zeitgeist about supply and logistics chains.
Are we the baddies?
Oh. Anyway, they have a very strong presence in all types of gaming media. Also unrelated, but the Dark Eye tabletop game isn't bad either. That's what Drakenzang is based on. Anyway, back to my initial point. So, it makes sense for the games to have initially been in German, because the German speaking market was large enough to support these types of endeavors, and then later translated. Which is what obviously happened to Anno 1503, because when you dig into the game's library feature, which thankfully the game has, you will find parts of it in German. My guess is that these were actually images as opposed to text, and they just forgot to replace them with English language ones. Don't worry, it's just tech tree stuff that are in German, but they are nicely illustrated with the things they refer to, so you won't have any issues understanding what's what. It's really not a big deal, but it is fun and funny thing to find in a 17-year-old game. Kinda like some sort of video game archaeology, if you would. I found it very hard to get into Anno 1503. Partly because of the lack of a nicely structured tutorial, the really cluttered and super busy interface, and the issues with running it on Windows 10. So I wouldn't jump into the Anno series with this one. Go with Anno 1701, or even better, Anno 1404. So on the 26th of May, the Anno History Collection was announced. Now, what this is basically an updating of the original 4 Anno titles, of which I have actually reviewed 3. Well, I'm reviewing the third right now. And in general, it's fairly good stuff. It makes the games work with modern day large resolutions. It adds in or fixes the multiplayer, memory usage, that sort of stuff. In general, it's good stuff. But then I looked at the pricing. The entire collection pack is gonna be 40 euro. And it's only gonna be available on Uplay. So basically, you'll be paying 10 euro per game. Going lower in the announcement, you actually notice that they're not actually 10 euro each. The first 3 games will be 10 euro if you buy them off of like Steam or Epic, but Anno 1404 is actually 15 euro because obviously Anno 1404, I think it's the best one, at least from the initial ones, for the non-space and non-1800 ones, and obviously that's the one that most people will be interested in, and they're pricing them at 10 and 15 euro. That is insane. These updates should have been done as a thank you to the massive Anno community that has been built up and that has been still maintaining the games in general gamer conscious. I wouldn't have found out about the Anno titles if not for this community. At the very most, this sort of an update, the titles should have been priced at maximum 5 euro, and even then, most of that money should be donated to charity. You greedy motherfuckers. You can go fuck yourselves in the ear, Ubisoft. Hard. In case you're interested in city building games, make sure to check out my city building playlist, which you should see on screen right about now.
Hey there, dear watcher who is still watching. Thank you very much for sticking around. I've recently started a Patreon page, so if you want and can throw a couple of bucks my way, go on there and check out the tiers and rewards. I've been Steven Nansens, thank you very much for watching, see you next time and have a great rest of your day.